Coddle. Classic Alliance.
They really don't want to have to drop down by losing this set, so this is something they've planned in practice, and that's why they're doing it. You don't pick Coddle second or first phase. Like,
it's not gonna get banned.
It's kind of cool versus Phoenix because of dive. Pretty cool against Slardar. Can counteract the Phoenix heal with your own heal nuke. Maybe that's the way you beat Sunray. Another Sunray.
I love the fact just that although amplified and then instantly blown up.
I love the fact that actually Purge animated that with his hands. You couldn't see it at home, but he actually animated that.
Another Sunray.
Okay, so what is the build for Coddle these days? Because I know that Mana Leak is very strong. Chakra Magic got buffed along the way.
Yeah, that could be the way they abuse it. Maybe they pick another hero that combos really well with Chakra Magic. Like something like Bristleback can be really good because you can quill twice right at the start of the game. You can pick somebody with like a low cooldown nuke or stun. Like, for example, Ursa can double Earth Clap or whatever instantly. Yeah. Something like that can be kind of cool.
But OG is thinking differently. They're just removing S4 heroes. And those are all, and I say S4 heroes because those are all heroes that can determine the tempo of the game real well.
Yeah. Exactly. And it's good to do if you have a Lindruid on your team because if you can control tempo somewhere else, Lindruid's usually taking towers.
Yep.
It's also the perfect combos. So, yeah, get them out. I still want to see if Slider can win. Like, Slider actually has one of the worst win percentages in this tournament right now. He's at 16.67% win rate.
Ooh, that's pretty bad.
And that's after he was picked six times.
That's really bad, actually.
It's actually the worst win rate like compared to how many times they're picked.
So he's only won one game, I guess?
Yeah, he has won one game.
I'm a little surprised about that. It was the most popular pick in the C region, at least for the regional qualifiers. Very different level of teams here, obviously, but...
Yeah.
Alchemist banned out as well. Another good minus armor hero that would have synergized great with Slardar. Like, the Lone Druid Bear would have been eaten alive repeatedly.
It's also a good ban out when, again, like, potentially OG could have just kept Alliance at bay. Keeper of the Light can take out Creep Waves, but normally he's a counter push, not a pusher himself. And you can make space with the Lone Druid, of course. But
yeah.
What are other S4 heroes that can determine the tempo of the game? I mean, Queen of Pain comes to mind, but...
I kind of like Quap. They need some disables for sure is one thing they're lacking. That's why either Puck or Barrett would have been okay.
Yeah.
Dragonite sort of works, but not really. It's not very good against Phoenix. Slardar has some solutions against it. So I don't really see Dragonite coming out for the Alliance, especially because they do want Lone Druid to be solo most of the time. They're going to be moving as force. They're going to need something that can fight kind of all the time.
Almost wonder if you go full Classic Alliance, bring S4's Invoker.
Yeah.
Oh, God, I haven't seen him play that hero in so long.
I know. That's why I said it's classic.
Is it really, though?
One thing that we also have to keep in mind, that when Ake played Keeper with the Light, he didn't used to go with people on lane, apart from PL sometimes, but he also was very efficient in farming jungles real fast.
Okay.
Is that still a thing you can do?
It's worse now because of magic resistance creeps.
Mm-hmm.
So probably definitely worse. I think Coddle's okay at battling early on. Honestly, you can get like at least one mana leak, go like a 2-1-2 build, something like that is pretty solid. It limits your leveling, but I mean, mana leak's really good this game.
Okay.
Slar and Phoenix are both a bit vulnerable. If you cast on Phoenix before he dives, for example, drains his mana, can't supernova. Straightforward kill there.
So if you're OG, what are you going to do if you're about to get cheese? What type of draft are you going to go for?
That's a harder
cheese
question.
Back.
Yeah. I mean, they've basically, this is their moment. They have two heroes to anticipate what's going to happen.
Yeah.
And almost always it's difficult to fully understand, especially when you got a Lone Druid Coddle opening. What are the lineups? Maybe split push, Ags on the Bear with recall, like split push shenanigans, perhaps?
This is perfect. If you feel like you're going to come under siege, you have a hero that could be anywhere supporting anyway.
Yep.
If you get an advantage, you're instantly pushing. That's what I was kind of actually hoping Alliance would have this hero.
Yeah, I was thinking about that too a moment ago. It's like maybe Loda plays Lone Druid and Bulldog does the Prophet offlane or something like that. That would kind of be cool. But for now, the Prophet will be global. So if they're looking into something with recall, then that won't be abusable. Maybe they can shift their strat a bit. Not that they really need to fully adjust just based on Prophet, but Alliance should stick to what they were planning to do, basically.
Yeah.
And OG should pick something that is synergistic in what they want to do. I could definitely see them pick up an Invoker. They've been doing Invoker Phoenix constantly. Slaughter on top of that. Lots of right-click damage with Prophets, TPing. And I think that's pretty good against high ground push stuff, which maybe what Alliance does here.
Legion so. Commander.
Okay.
Legion Commander. Where is your synergy?
How do you see Legion Commander attack? As a tempo controller?
No, he's good at that. I mean, he sets up ganks, stuff mm-hmm. like that. You can also remove stun from Sardar. He can yeah. also press the attack the bear to make the bear attack
actually,
really
yeah.
fast.
That's nice. So ooh, and if you have that in combination with Evoker? Alacrity bear?
Alacrity. And the only thing you need is an ogre to cap up your lineup.
Yeah.
You're right.
there you go.
They were one of the first teams to do that, actually. Yeah. At TI3, they picked ogre, and it didn't go well. But it was cool to see a try.
This is going to be so difficult now.
Yeah, with the tinker.
Yeah. Like pushing into this is so difficult. So now, like, you got great counter push, you got great split push. Mm-hmm. Like, an OG need, like, two global catch outs. You almost need to have something like a spec as your last one, so someone that can kind of catch up to the Tinker and the Prophet.
Sort of. Like, the Legion's a great start. Coddle can work quite well also once he gets eggs, because he'll have, flying vision like Nightstalker. And that's why that's another reason why they banned Nightstalker, by the way. It looked like a totally normal ban. Fit right into their strat, though, because they just got beaten by Nightstalker. That was kind of nice.
How do they couple it?
Well, some follow-up stun would be good. They need burst damage really bad, because when Legion duels, they don't have anything ready afterwards, unless Coddle has been super ready and has the Illuminate ready to go.
Well, you still got one of the most popular heroes that's still in the pool for this tournament, and that's the Lion. So if you want burst damage, that's one way. But then you got a Lion and a Coddle support.
With the amount of time that Alliance is thinking about this draft, it kind of feels...
it's actually happening.
It kind of feels like they are... Because they started out picking everything really fast, right? And banning everything really fast. So it kind of feels like OG already picked what they wanted to go for. But buffing the bear, that's a thing.
If this really is the Invoker, like...
It's kind of a cool draft, honestly. Like, they just buff the bear up. The bear is going to attack towers really fast. I'm sure they'd love to have a Beastmaster as well, but... It's basically bear buff, ganks from Legion, and Ogre, Coddle. If Ogre gets semi-farmed, Coddle can Chakra Magic him, and he can double stun with Unrefined. That's going to be potentially really strong. Mm-hmm. But once BKBs come out, I just feel like Alliance's draft is going to fall flat. Like, this looks like a cool theory-crafted team, but and we haven't seen the last pick, but Coddle, Ogre, like, they don't have good team fight at all. And I feel like OG is going to run them over in that way.
VS is the final ban.
Well, that would have been OG's hero. Okay.
Yeah.
They can swap whoever's dueled. Would have been a really good counter to.
They don't really have a save.
You could always all.
Okay. All right. This is another way to do it. With Chakra Magic on Coddle, it's going to give. And this is the other piece we're missing. Coddle didn't synergize with any of the lineup, really. But now it's quite good. Storm Spirit can TP to a lane, counter push, recall him back. They can give him mana.
A jump and chase that's not reliant on items actually being on your heroes.
Yeah, so he's any counters Tinker, any counters Nature's Prophet, and if he gets an Orchid, he's good against Phoenix. He's a little even against Slardar. I like Slardar versus Storm, but this is a good pick. With Legion backing that up, the Earth Spirit's going to offset it a little bit, but Legion should cover a lot of the disables coming out of
OG. Is this like one of the first games we haven't seen Lion Bandle picked?
Yep.
Yeah.
I want to believe. I know you're going to ask, but I want to believe.
Alfredo, also, but
got this.
Alliance all the way.
Yep.
Alliance all the way. The ogre was called. I'm presuming you're on the ogre train.
You know, I was all for Alliance to try and dictate the pace of the game and actually have a win scenario. In this one, if the Storm Spirit can actually get some momentum, then I'll believe in Alliance. But at the moment, I swing more the way of OG. I actually feel like their draft is a lot easier to execute and has a lot less variables.
Yeah, it's a bit more of a standard draft, isn't it?
I love the smirk on
Purge's face. What we're used
to,
but you can't but be pleased. The Alliance have been ballsy here, to say the least.
I'm excited about their draft. I just think it's one of those that I love to watch, but it's not. It's so like theory crafted that it's
they've not
maybe
convinced
impractical.
You, have they? They've
I like the OG
you.
Draft better just because it looks so much safer. It's all stuff they play. It's stuff that's truly in the meta. Can they make Ogre work, for example, with Legion Commander and Coddle? That's like three heroes that are iffy.
Because you actually have to agree with me.
Yeah, that was
Well, that's harsh as well. We've got consternation on the panel right now. They're in dispute. We'll leave them to dispute a little bit more as we head over to our Capitalist and Blitz commentary team.
So I mean, at this point in time, teams are just making it, like, they're lowballing it, you know? I don't know how Storm Spirits just keep on popping up whenever we cast together, but Alliance have drafted one. They also have a Legion Commander safe lane. Some interesting stuff from the Alliance team, but Do you kind of agree with Purge that it just looks like OG's lineup is just easier to execute and you kind of want to back that just because of that?
Yeah, at the same time, I do agree that OG's lineup is pretty easy to execute. Like, their goals to victory a lot clearer, but I think that's mainly just because we never see heroes like Caudill and Ogre into the game, mm-hmm. especially Legion Commander. Like, Alliance have a draft that hasn't really been in vogue ever, really. This just seems like a weird combination of heroes, but I've long since started doubting S4. Like, this guy just does whatever he wants and wins. Of course, you're going to ask me how Storm stacks up against that lineup. It's like the one thing I should answer.
Yeah, the Tinker mid matchup, right? I want to know at least how the laning phase goes.
Oh, maybe they actually just do Storm safe lane. Yeah, it is going to be Storm safe lane.
Okay.
They're going to allow Lone Druid to go one-on-one against the Tinker. I think that's fine.
Yeah,
although
that
Miracle
right.
just got Bounty Rune and just ate the ward. In this game overall, though, I think Storm goes pretty ham.
Not too much lockdown. I did like the Air Spirit response from OG.
Yeah.
It helped out significantly, and it would have put like a lot more pressure on the Storm Spirit mid very early on, but this is in part why Alliance are running the Lone Druid mid. The combination of nukes that Tinker is able to apply, right, and the ganking power of the Air Spirit makes this mid lane more of the hard lane than anything else.
I sort of think Storm against Tinker, one of the easiest ways to deal with Tinker in general. I think the item build for S4, depending on how the game goes, is most likely Bloodstone into Orchid into BKB, or maybe you even decide to go for the BKB second, depending on the flow of the game. Like, if he's just getting crushed, then he's probably going to grab the BKB second, but...
BGM, you're so mean. Look at him. He goes behind the Tier 1 tower, actually gets a deny on the range creep, doing everything in his power, but yeah, we're going to see Legion Commander go down. Lota just a bit too far forward. Good rotation.
Also, I really like the way that OG are utilizing No-Tail. I think before, by giving him the traditional 1 or 2 position, he wasn't really properly utilized, but giving him more the utility kind of role, where he can do it all, play the vision game for his team, and kind of play him sort of like the offlane role in some ways.
Yeah, he's kind of like, yeah, the 3 position, and Moon kind of steps into like a 2 kind of initiating sort of role, where he's very disruptive and stuff in team fights. And Miracle, of course, we've long talked about he is, you know, always the carry on OG.
Yeah. This is going to be a matchup, though, Bulldog mid is going to feel really comfortable with. I know this guy plays this hero in pretty much any lane. The sheer amount of games that he has with this hero also lends itself to being a comfort pick for Alliance.
That being said, Admiral Bulldog did seem to have an off game earlier. We talked about in between the game how he's supposed to be like this really good 1v1 player, but he did kind of lose that lane, and now he's going to be feeling a lot of pressure as the Earth Spirit successfully gets the roll in and allows Miracle to be able to clean up the kills. So not just a 1v1 matchup, that's for sure. OG continuing to try and keep him out of the game as much as possible.
Yeah, and already OG are putting a lot of pressure on the lanes, which I think is really good for them to do. You want to make it so that the Storm has to do everything to beat you. And in a game where Storm is significantly behind, of course, going to have a much tougher time. Laning phase-wise, advantage so far for OG.
Mm-hmm. Right, that's now, purely off of rotations, right? Alliance, the idea of this was supposed to be that they would have just really successful, like a 2-1-2 kind of scenario. But the Earth Spirit last pick opened things up a whole lot more for OG. You can't really get a better 4 position to kind of take advantage of the mid lane not having any rotating heroes of their own.
I think they just assumed that Lota would have an easier time up at bottom, but that Sunray is
so much damage. Lota still actually doesn't have a level of press the attack, which I would assume is part of the idea behind Lota being able to be here in this bottom lane, because he can spam it out so much with the help of Ake's Chakra Magic.
Yep. The cool thing about Alliance's lineup, though, is they have a lot of different ways to pump up heroes for free. They've got Press the Attack, they've obviously got Ogre.
Ooh, the roll misses from Crit. He does manage to get the kick, but I don't think that means much. Lota turns around, throws out the nuke for the extra movement speed, and that'll be the end of that attempt at an engagement. Front middle lane just barely caught the tail end of Admiral Bulldog going down to the Heat-Seeking Missile. Miracle takes the small advantage that Crit was able to afford him with the gank early on, and now pushes that for so much more with the maxed out nukes build against that squishy Admiral Bulldog Lone Druid pre-level 6.
And even with the rotation from the Earth Spirit mid, you almost never want to be in a position where you're solo dying. We talked about it in the last game, and it just feels like Bulldog has been struggling in these last two games. The Earth Spirit rotation hurts, but that additional kill is going to make things even harder for it to catch up. As a bottom, Fly going to get nuked down, and now we're starting to see some stability out of this bottom lane for Alliance. But it's going to be this top lane right now that is going so well for them. Storm obviously countering a lot of the heroes on OG. It just remains to be seen whether or not he can do a lot of this heavy lifting, because they are going to rely on him quite a lot if these lanes continue to go the way that they are.
Yeah, I mean, he's going to be the primary hero to shut down the Tinker and keep him controlled even as you go later on into
Nature's
the game.
Prophet.
Nature's Prophet as well, another great example of an intelligence sort of split-pushing style hero.
They have a lot of ways to help him out too, with the Keeper of the Light, the Chakra, obviously the press the attack from the Legion Commander will get rid of any silences or stuns as long as they don't get connected on together.
Okay, Moon and EGM. Not even stopping for a right click, just passing each other by. EGM will soak up the experience in mid now that Lone Druid is going to go full jungle, and Moon will take the opportunity to 1v1 against S4 Storm Spirit. Of course, they can afford to leave S4 alone now, just as he's about to hit level 6. The roll in middle lane is going to be able to catch EGM, follow it up with a kick, and Miracle should be able to kill him with the Heat Seeking Missile to finish Mop Fairy Fire going out. EGM's tanky beast, but oh, the healing salve is going to be able to actually keep him alive. Natural tankiness of the Ogre Madai, you won't see any other support but Ogre being able to survive through a gank attempt like that.
9 armor. They were right-clicking him so many different times, but they just weren't able to bring him down. And he's just going to throw out some spells, try to get some free levels at the same time. Moon up at top, I think he realized Storm is one of the weaker safe lane heroes in the sense that he can't really provide much for you in terms of kill potential. You're going to remnant on the ground and right-click somebody with an overload.
Right. Have to be a major mispositioning of Moon early on to die to this. So should be able to start getting some farm. Didn't get much to early on just because of the way that EGM was playing. He was essentially just saying, okay, I've got all this armor against a pure physical damage hero and Slardar, both the crush as well as his right click. So I'll just trade hits constantly. And that kept Moon away from being able to CS.
Yeah. And Loda just continues to farm during this time period. Soul Ring's going to be completed on S4, so he's going to go for the Bloodstone first. It's just a common item, and I think this guy just needs to power farm. They don't really have the best ways to create space for each other, is the one downside of Alliance's lineup. If you just look at all the heroes that they have, Lone Druid inherently doesn't gank. Ogre has two abilities that have some burst potential, but he really needs levels. And he's even better at just fighting throughout a long team fight and not just that initial gank.
Right.
Legion Commander's that instant burst that you need, but he doesn't really have something that can pair with it. Like, neither of the supports, pre-level 6, especially on the Ogre, provide him too much in terms of DPS. Yeah. So getting some duels is going to be hard.
And they're both pretty slow, even if they do get to a point where they're able to go more of a solo route. Or even just trying to initiate for some allies to follow him up. It's still going to take a while to get to that point. You could say Storm Spirit and Legion Commander kind of share timings in that regard. So the 10-15 minute marker is going to be too open. Moon, he does have a crush. S4 is trying to keep his distance away from Moon. He will be able to claim that last hit. Very nicely played. Positioning game, almost going to go down to Miracle. May end up dying to Furion as he comes in. Last little jump from S4. He is able to get out. Miracle starts spamming out the wave, but they really wanted to be able to claim a counter kill with two core rotations like that to
that
the
was
top lane.
Exceedingly well done by S4, mana management wise. It was cool to see. He even had the Soul Ring too, just in case. The Nature's Prophet had committed the TP already, he knows that. Waits that extra half beat and gets the solo kill too on that Slardar. As soon as you saw the Slardar commit the stun, it was a guaranteed kill.
Yeah.
I think he can even output probably around 180 more damage too, if you take into account the overload and the right clicks. So he had well within his rights to kill him.
Seeing Bulldog was a bit hesitant to come up to this top lane. He finally did and was able to get to the deny in the tier 1 tower, but you can kind of see why. It's a scary venture. Crit was actually looking for an opening to roll on in. But of course the Lone Druid, now that he's level 7, he's actually relatively tanky if he wants to go into his true form, and he's still got that Savage Roar to be able to depend on, so.
Up at top, Bulldog did a very good job too, scouting with the boar, with the bear first to make sure that nothing was coming his way. Obviously you make that play, just no reason not to.
Just the machines.
That must have been really confusing. Yeah. So that is a medium camp that I got 0 gold from. and at bottom, Alliance are doing a really good job of avoiding all fights. And what's inevitably going to happen is I think OG is going to feel like they have to make something happen, but pre-blink to farm.
Okay, I love his positioning here, being able to get that really aggressive ward on the cliff relatively early on, and farming up the neutrals, which actually denies Miracle a decent amount of farm. He's probably expecting a lot more from that March of the Machines.
That must have been really confusing. Yep. So that is a medium camp that I got zero gold from. And at bottom, Alliance are doing a really good job of avoiding all fights. And what's inevitably going to happen is I think OG is going to feel like they have to make something happen, but pre-blink dagger on that Slaughter, it's going to be difficult.
That comes down to S4 being able to get that kill, keeping the Slardar blink at bay. It might just be long enough for Alliance to be the ones who really take control of the tempo first. We'll see as the armlet is going to be coming in soon for Loda. S4, his farm is obviously quite good, 4,200 net worth right now, just shy of the Tinker's 4,500.
This is a very good Storm game so far, and this is what we surmised too coming into this draft, right? That part of the reason why they picked Storm is because you almost counter two of the cores already on the side of OG, maybe even three. As Storm isn't too bad against Slardar either. You don't mind Slardar. If you can survive the initial stun with Press the Attack or anybody grabs a Force Staff.
Time for Miracle to secure this Tier 1, spamming out March of the Machines, maybe Heat Seeking Missile or two. Alliance are going to be in a tough position to deal with this. They don't have the initiation, and they're not even going to really bother. They're just going to allow Ake to Luminate Blast a couple of times, do something there. But otherwise, as you said before, the game name of the game for Alliance is just farming. They stick at the bottom lane with Loda. Admiral Bulldog not showing himself at top, probably because he thinks there's a little bit too dangerous with so many heroes off map, so instead he's doing some jungling. But it doesn't really seem like they're going to contest.
They are setting up with S4 here. They've even brought it back and something at the last hit.
Okay, Alliance, 2 for 2 on denies when it comes to the towers.
Still, Alliance is making the correct move here. Just try to delay things with Aki as much as you can with the Keeper of the Light pick, which I think was the general idea here, and continue to just allow your cores to farm. You know that a Midas Lone Druid is not going to offer you much in the way of fighting. Storm Spirit does not want to fight in a game like this, Cap. He just wants to avoid farm, farm, farm. Legion Commander going armlet first is kind of in a similar situation too.
So OG essentially knowing that they can't quite like fully force fights without the blink dagger on the Slardar are still trying to choke out Alliance, knowing that they're spending such a large time farming. That's where the tier one tower push at both top and middle comes from, trying to isolate Alliance's map control a little bit more.
This but passive gaming,
they gotta get a little bit more, right?
Yeah. I agree with that, but besides, the issue with OG's lineup is they only have one hero that can reasonably push on their side, which is the Nature's Prophet. The rest of the heroes are sort of sit back and let things happen.
Fly, careful there. We'll be able to get the Icarus dive away.
Ogre's so tanky. Notice Alliance's lineup. They just continue to farm throughout everything, and now they're winning in net worth. They're just dominating right now in XP, up 3,000. As a result of everything, and No-Tail's gonna run into S4 here, but it'll just be one of those bumping into each other.
Yeah, it's not really like there's, oh, who's gonna get killed, what? It's more of how many neutral creep camps can you take as S4 before the rotation comes in from OG? That's the real victory at hand here.
Yeah, and S4 is even gonna drop the Remnant on the ground. It's a very common play from Storms. You wanna stay here and not get zoned out just because he has a lot of mana to work with again. At bottom, S4 knows that's a solo Slardar, but it is scary to make that rotation on top of him.
Yeah. He's going to try and get some damage out now, and if he successfully dodges at a crush, maybe he can continue to force it, but Moon doesn't blow it. He had the backup, the Furion attempting a TP as well. No-Tail actually going for a Blade Mail build here. Nature's Prophet, this is more of an active, like early combative build on the Nature's Prophet. Despite the game slowing down, is that the right idea for a Furion in this game?
Not entirely sure. I think part of the reason why he got it is because it is okay against the Storm. It makes it so that he can never jump on you. But they, OG just...
At the same time, you're not able to out-greed Alliance, or at least play the greed game with this Furion if you had, say, a different build like Midas.
Yeah. Because right now, that's what's happening. Alliance are avoiding all fights. They're sticking their Keeper of the Light into all these engagements, making sure that it's not easy for OG to push because they have one pushing hero. they don't really have... OG also don't have the best heroes to punish pre-Blink Dagger Slardar. So all Alliance is doing right now is they're taking advantage of it. They're outmaneuvering them around the map. They're farming with all of their cores. And most importantly, because Admiral Bulldog has this Midas, he just continues to scale ahead. So even though the score looks 3-1 and OG took that early engagement lead, it's just Alliance playing really passively, and they're playing this really frustrating style of Dota for OG to match.
So in other words, guys, just take like half of the analysis that we said for last game about OG and just replace it with Alliance. Same kind of like very defensive style, playing more the farming and knowing that their timing's going to be coming up. They actually find a pick here on No Tail. The Blade Mail is going to protect him here as they already got the jump up, or maybe actually fly just in the perfect time, the Sunray. Always the offset of both healing and damage being done to the enemy allows the fight to go in the favor of OG, or at least keeps the Furion alive.
Yeah. Ake barely missed on that Illuminate right there. Just clipped the bottom of the screen. Wasn't able to grab him with him. It's going to allow him to survive, but Blink Dagger now completed on Miracle. He is incredibly farmed. The rest of his team not doing as hot, but he is playing really aggressively with how far he's pushing up. As a result, he's doing quite well in experience and net worth.
It's got to be the most boring game for heroes like Phoenix and Ogre.
Hey,
because like there's like so many heroes farming. I mean, Crit at least had a fun laning phase. You know, he had opportunities to do things.
Yeah, you tell him that after this game. After 10 minutes, the game just became him farming with an Earth Spirit. You know, no Earth Spirit player wants this game to be this passive.
Yeah, it's like farming with a bounty hunter. Like, why?
Yeah.
But that's the nature of this game right now. We'll have things ramp up pretty quickly, though, right? Because now we have very key item for OG when it comes to the Slardar Blink Dagger. We have the Bloodstone about to be up for S4. He's getting there, and that'll obviously be kind of a timing where you want to try and get some kills. And sure enough, Moon, there it is. The first kill that we've seen in a long time. Looks like EGM is going to be the victim of the Moon Blink Dagger reveal.
Not the best target that you wanted to try to kill on the Blink Dagger reveal, but still, anything to get the game rolling and just kind of spice things up for your team. Now you see 4-1, you're going to feel a little bit better about how this game is going, but I think OG are wising to the fact that they have to push the pace. Once the Storm gets Bloodstone, maybe he just keeps dodging. That's...
We almost went 10 minutes without a kill.
It's
quite the passive laning phase that both of these... two teams have chosen to adopt with this draft.
I don't think OG wanted to do this.
Yeah, that's true.
Like, they wanted to push the pace of the game with their lineup. They just don't really have the heroes for it, especially against the Keeper of the Light, who just spams out waves. You've got a Bulldog who's incredibly hard to kill. OG have to overcommit to kill this hero and forget about even killing Storm.
And again, you're seeing Alliance making all the reads. Just like OG was able to dodge some of the smoke ganks last game, you're seeing Alliance reading some of the movements. Not here, though. Ake is going to be the one off. But again, OG, that kind of commitment, just like at the top lane with the Blink Dagger, just getting a support isn't quite what they envisioned.
Yeah, what I was going to say is Alliance are actually leading with their supports head first before any of their cores go there. Mm-hmm. Even with Storm being the most hypermobile carry in the game, they weren't really willing to sacrifice his positioning to show himself on the map.
Top lane's pushing in, and you don't really have good control of your jungle. Well, send a support up
there.
He's
just like poking him forward. He's like, don't worry, man. I've got your back.
And then as soon as he jumps, he's like, oh, yeah, that place is a terrible place to be. I'm out.
Good luck, Ake. Poor Ake.
Behind tier two. EGM, once again, the support of Alliance goes down, and now we're going to see a repeat as Ake almost ends up going down 2 HP. OG now laying control over this tier 2 tower, being able to push back that nasty Keeper of the Light. No more Illuminate Blast to slow them down.
Just continue to farm on the side of Alliance. No reason to take any of these fights early on. You've already got, I didn't even realize, they already have Relic on Bulldog. He's almost about to finish the Radiance, and they're going to get a Bloodstone. They have benefited heavily from this type of playstyle. That is the full Bloodstone completed on S4.
With the Keeper of the Light, you're able to play like such a heavier split pushing game too as Storm Spirit, right? Because you just zip to a side lane, you get recalled back, get some free mana.
I think Keeper of the Light is one of my three favorite supports to play with. Mm-hmm. Just because he allows you the freedom and flexibility to kind of do whatever you want. No Tail's going to go on that cliff of death. And I do like this move by Alliance, though, to scout out their jungle. Meanwhile, OG is farming their own jungle, don't think they feel comfortable anymore just because they know that Alliance have hit most of their item timings.
There really is so much deja vu in this game, too. I remember having a conversation about how, you know, Alliance were securing their jungle, you know, last time around, sweeping through the Dire side, trying to, you know, make sure that they had some room to farm and push out.
This time, though, they have much better late gamers.
Yeah, absolutely.
Moon's going to show himself at top.
And they're going to be able to catch something here. EG Hemp. These poor supports.
That's life.
It's like you're going fishing, you know? Every single time you throw support out there, he wriggles around a little bit. OG will immediately snap on the bait.
Yeah. He doesn't care. His lone druid's got a radiance of 20 minutes to go along with 700 gold and a Midas.
He's like, ultimately, what am I? I'm a bloodlust for my lone druid bear. Yeah.
I do like this changeup and build, by the way, with Storm. Oftentimes you saw the four levels of the Static Remnant, and I think I was talking to... I can't remember. I think Keenan in the elevator, we were discussing Storm builds. And I said, because you can't go for the jungle anymore, you go for this... you just go for two levels of the Vortex because that's enough to complete the combo. Mm-hmm. Whereas before, you would leave it for level 1. But because of that gap that you hit, you know, when you hit level 11, it becomes really difficult to level it up. So you want at least two levels if you're going to get this Bloodstone.
Yeah.
If that made any sense. That sounded like gibberish in my head.
It did a little bit. I was just laughing to myself that even in your downtime, you're talking about Storm Spirit.
Yeah. You got to. It's fun. We can theorycraft some cool stuff now. With the way that
like
the jungle,
the Agadims?
With the way that the jungle changed, this is probably only interesting to me. But now that you can change the Storm build into getting two earlier levels of the Vortex,
spamming away, hoping to be able to take the tier one. I mean, this is about the time you start thinking about Roshan, right? OG, they've had a hard time being able to wrestle control of the tempo of this game away from Alliance, but if you can, with this Slardar, claim yourself an Aegis, maybe you can force fights and take objectives with a little bit more confidence.
Sorry, it was hard to hear you over Miracle just spamming out March of the Machines. With a regen rune.
Things got pretty loud.
Yeah, he went for that Aetherless build, by the way. I think we saw somebody do that this weekend.
Yeah. I actually asked somebody about it.
Was it mid one? It was one of the qualifier games for sure.
Yeah, and I think there was actually two or three games, maybe, of either lens in recent memory.
What'd you hear about it?
I asked some people about it. He said it seems like kind of a nice build-up item.
Second kill of the game.
Hey, Alliance doubling their kills at 22 minutes.
Oh, you know what I just realized about Alliance's lineup? It infinitely scales. Dual plus Bloodstone charges.
Know this about Blitz, he has like the biggest obsession with infinitely scaling Dota Dota lineups. Anytime you have a Legion Commander, he's just like, oh yes, Silencer.
How can you
he's
lose
all over Silencer?
In a theoretical 700 minute game, Alliance would win this game 10 times out of 10. There's no way they wouldn't.
Well, with Alliance's current playstyle, they do seem. To be making this possible that they can push it to 700 minutes.
Yeah, look how cool that gank was. They just got dual damage plus a Bloodstone charge. That's sick. Uh-huh. That goes beyond the gold. This has got to be so frustrating for OG to play against, though.
Yeah.
It's one of those situations where they know they can't do anything because all of Alliance's heroes are so hard to kill. But at the same time, what are they supposed to do?
And now they're getting to a point where they can't even play like aggressively without any kind of abandon. Because there's plenty of pickoff opportunity now for Alliance between Legion Commander with some sort of smoke play in the duel, as well as the Storm Spirit.
Miracle, though, has been the rock so far for OG in this game, continues to steadily farm. If Tinker gets 4 or 5 slotted in a game like this, it could be incredibly hard for Alliance to try to go uphill.
Yeah, and that's why their timing is going to be like not quite like super late game, despite the infinitely scaling aspect of them, right? It's going to be more that 40-minute marker. You don't want to try and let a Tinker. Like, Tinker's one of those kind of like, you never know what's going to happen late game with a Tinker because...
Oh, I guess he infinitely scales too because of his... That's so sick. All right, for Alliance, though, he's going to go for the Orchid, by the way, on the Storm. And the main reason for this is because they're doing just fine and he has the Aegis. Can afford not to go with the PKB earlier.
Tinker, Furion, these two heroes, the pickoff heroes that we were talking about before, they're pretty easily abused by Orchid as well. This kind of forces. What do you go as Tinker at this point to deal with the Orchid? Is it Yule Scepter or?
I think you just try not to die.
Just try not to die, says Blitzdota.
That's my advice. Predict where the storm. Miracle's so good that he'll do it.
I understand why people, so many people pay you for coaching now.
I appreciate it.
Just try not to die. That'll be $700, please.
Miracle just. For Miracle, it probably works. Just between games, oh, you die too much. Just play a little bit better.
And Miracle's like, ah, I got you, fam. All right, I got you.
He just understands.
He's just like all of a sudden is able to break down the whole entire game in his head and know exactly why he died every single time.
Oh, I see what scenario you're talking about.
that guy, I've heard different pro players talk about him too. And he's kind of like one of those like absurdly talented people that like other talented people within Dota 2 were just like, yeah, that guy's insane. I think it was like Swindles or somebody. It was like that guy just seems to be able to map out like a whole entire team fight in his head. It's not that he plays like super fast necessarily. It's just the fact that he seems to know like all of the timings of everything that's happening in a team fight and position himself accordingly.
Yeah. But right now, they are going to ask a lot out of him on the side of OG. He has to do, at the rate this game is going at.
Oh, jump on mid. Blade mail versus blade mail. But they do have the little bit of extra help of the Sunray over the top. And that might mean Loda actually loses this fight. No tail. Winner, winner there. And now they've actually taken away the Aegis from the Storm Spirit as well. They're going to try and gauge. Oh, nice kickback there from Ake. But he immediately dies to Miracle. S4 is on his way out and will be able to get away. But EGM, not so lucky. Quick bash there. Phoenix Egg actually preventing S4 from being able to respond as OG go on EGM. Now they jump forward. S4, is he actually going to be caught here? They don't. They do have a silence coming up soon. S4 pulls the last remnants of his mana, and they're able to catch him out.
That is not what they wanted out of that fight. That Sunray did so much work against Loda, and Alliance just beat away four heroes. They thought with the Aegis advantage that they had, they were just
like
gonna roll in.
It was like the cleanest, you know, they weren't feeding away almost any excessive kills. It was always supports that they were giving away. It was just like, you know, such a clean game from Alliance, getting what they wanted, slowing down the game, getting farm. And then one massive misstep like that in the mid lane just cost them everything. That was four heroes down. That was Bloodstone charges and an Aegis loss for S4. So he's back to the old Bloodstone now.
That was
eight charges.
That was crazy by Alliance. When they took that fight, before they took that fight, they were up 5k in XP, they were up 3,000 in net worth, and it just continued to climb. With how low their supports were doing, that just means your cores are even richer.
Yeah.
Our Bulldog's already got an AC going on him. They didn't even take the fight with him. They just assumed with the Aegis on Storm and how farmed he was, they'd be able to win that fight easily, but OG have a lot of team fight. This is what OG was waiting for Alliance to slip up and fight into them. And as soon as that happens, look how much they grab out of it.
Yeah, not only the metrics changed now, but they got a little bit of extra control, taking that tier 2, and it seems like they're going to get this bottom lane eventually. I can only presume that OG has that on their short list.
Their ability to infinitely scale turned on them, too. They gave away dual damage.
We got to talk about it.
Oh, top?
No.
No-Till's got a Hex?
Jesus, that is so early, too. S4 is still silenced up. Now they have the Sunray. He's actually going to go down again. Ake's up next. And EGM just has to clap his hands 3 times and teleport back home, which he'll do so successfully. But you think of the Storm Spirit and the infinitely scaling, but he just keeps going down, down, and down. 5 Bloodstone charges.
Maybe
now
two.
Mid lane. Admiral Bulldog tries to actually, no, he misses the Savage Roar. So Nailtail manages to sprout him in. The stun still lands. Admiral Bulldog trapped inside the trees and won't ever be able to escape that bouncing laser as well. Actually kind of effective versus that lone druid. The bear unable to do any damage to Nailtail in return.
All of this action is just ramped up all at once. Nailtail plays that fight perfectly up at top, even makes his way mid. And this is what I'm talking about. When he gets to play these heroes, the Nature Prophets, the Beastmasters, you're going to see him be so successful. And now S4 is in a weird situation where he doesn't have a BKB built up. He didn't expect that early Hex coming out of Nailtail. And all of this stat build makes him so hard to kill and up at top. They're going to go for it again.
Not again. He's going to be inside the vice up. They're going to be able to combo up the stuns as well. If he survived through this, no chance at hell. The amplified damage. They're just able to lay into him in a quarter second.
What has happened in this game? All control has been lost from Alliance. All off of that one engagement. They were in a perfectly good scenario. Now all of a sudden, it just looks like heroes are being picked off left and right. It took 10 minutes for OG to get their third kill of the game.
It's almost like Alliance now. One slip of control, and now they're just trying to wrestle it back with their positioning, but they just keep on getting caught out. EGM's the next victim. of OG's Rampage through this 16-2. As you can see, that net worth graph has flipped on its head. 3K to Alliance not so long ago has now gone 3K in the favor of OG.
This is one of the more dramatic just ramp-ups in a game that I've seen in a really long time. At one point, it was 7-2. Alliance were steadily farming with everybody. The only heroes that they had really lost, aside from the laning phase, were supports. And this is the ideal situation to be in. And this is why we were talking as if Alliance did have the advantage. Because at one point, before all these slip-ups had happened and all these individual pickups, they were doing great.
Yeah.
Then one fight happens mid. Then they just start to lose heroes one by one, and it is just snowballed for them.
Miracle, let's talk about this build finally. The Aghanims on the Tinker, the Aether Lens. Miracle twice now has gone for a bit of a different build from the traditional style that we've seen with these heroes. First the Alchemist, now the Tinker.
He's really tanky, and the amount of damage that he puts out is really high, especially against the Lone Druid. And against S4, he can't really afford to burst him anymore. And Alliance now, what they were doing is splitting up and farming everywhere, and they were just getting so much efficiency, but after those three pickoffs in a row, all led by No-Tail, game just completely turns against them, and OG are looking to be in a really dominant position. Net worth-wise, the three cores from Alliance are still in really stable shape. It's just the rest of the heroes that have really fallen off for them, and teamfight-wise, OG are also in a really good position with this early Hex pickup from No-Tail.
Well, the Courier pickoff, that'll definitely help out quite a bit. Say goodbye to 3,800. So that was both the Soul Booster and the Shiva's Guard.
There's a Blink Dagger and a gem picked up, by the way, by Crit. Just understanding that they have finally gotten a lot of map control. I'm going to try to parlay that into just looking for more individual pickoffs and keeping Alliance on their toes is the right idea at this point.
Yeah, again, if they can kind of see S4 coming and limit any potential comeback by him and getting hero pickoffs, they're going to be pretty happy. You could see the way that Crit's already lining up behind No-Tail just in case there is an attempt to go. But I'm pretty sure S4 can't even kill him.
Oh, this is going to be
the Orchid versus Scythe of Ice.
If you look at Bulldog's build, too, this is going to be an Aghanim's Lone Druid. Not something that I've personally seen in a pro game.
I mean, that's all the more feeding into the split push. The Alliance and Surgeon Corps earlier, but a gank on the Spirit Bear. Holy cow. Man, Slaughter is so good versus the Lone Druid.
That cost them nothing, too. The Hex is going to be up on off of cooldown in 10 seconds. The Sun Ray plus the amp damage cuts through him so quickly up at top.
Yeah, OG keeping up the tempo. They want to actually go for more here, and they're actually going to run in right into Nolota. No-Tail is going to go for the duel here and might be able to win it too, as Crit is trying to help out with the damage. Unfortunately, they're both silenced up now thanks to the Orchid. The Sunray just comes in a little bit too late to help out the allies, but does manage to get the kill on both, as the silence lasts long enough for Miracle to be able to come in with the heavy nukes, and they're going to get another one here potentially. Oh, Moon missing out on that stun. Ake still has all the vision on him, and I'm presuming the Dinkert is going to be able to come in with the extra bit of damage to finish him off. One more rearm, blink forward, and a heat-seeking missile. And a laser just to make sure. Double kill on Miracle.
He just continues to get more and more farmed, and we talked about it beforehand. When we thought he was going to have issues against that Blade Mail Armlet Blink Dagger Legion Commander and that Orchid with Storm, we gave him the best advice, just don't die.
He listened.
Yeah, he hasn't died once. 7-0-6.
What a player. Now Alliance.
Three Bloodstone charges,
I mean,
on
between,
that Storm.
Between the Ags, the Storm Spirit having nothing, really. I mean, he's so few Bloodstone charges for this late into the game. And then, you know, Lota hasn't really progressed that much either, as he hasn't gotten those dual damage that really allow him to ramp up. It's getting kind of close to the time, isn't it, for OG to start taking some more objectives and locking down this map even further?
I think they're still feeling comfortable with the amount of map control that they have, just because of their ability to get anywhere instantly. They've got Tinker and Nature's Prophet that have that instant TP. You've got hypermobile heroes like this Slardar and this Earth Spirit that can actually follow them around. They're often aren't a lot of heroes that can do that, but with the sprint and the blink daggers that they both have, really easy for them to keep up when it comes to the speed at which they're playing.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, the Hex Nature's Prophet has been so successful for them, and with the amount of HP that he's built up for him, with grabbing all these side stat items, with the blade mail and the drums, it's hard for Alliance to pick off anybody cleanly, but they're going to go for this Roshan, maybe. try to get something started, because they know map control just isn't in their favor, and straight up pushes aren't either. But
10 more already seconds.
No-till. He already has that treant inside. This is just good predictive play. But maybe they'll sneak by. Lions. They're pinging like they want it.
I'm going to try and go back in.
Yeah, I think they realize their situation has become really desperate after all these pickoffs.
Oh, man. They're going to need S4 to get this Aegis and somehow be able to be a part of a ton of fights. Step one is going to be claimed by Alliance, but now step two, the team fight. Oh, geez, we actually still try and force this one. They've got really good positioning. They're going to be able to pop one immediately. Ake ends up going down. Admiral Bulldog teeping into that tier two, but unable to help out his ally. The BKB charge used by Loda. Alliance now on full retreat.
They're looking for EGM, but barely manages to get out as
well. They're going to
catch
bear.
The bear.
Yeah, it's practically a hero anyway.
Do you see how quickly that thing dies?
Yeah.
Like, OG are not even afraid. That is a 20k net worth bear. That just instantly goes down.
Sunray, amplify damage. They actually have so many good things versus the bear.
Yeah.
Even laser, like when it comes to the actual fights itself, laser is going to be really effective because you just won't have that kind of immunity on a spirit bear.
4-20 is the scoreline as Alliance being beaten back into their face, even with the Aegis available on Storm, not really looking to fight as there are so many marches down. Fly waiting for any opportunity to get that egg off. He has a Lincoln's completed on that Phoenix, making it even harder for Storm to do anything.
And Ake's dead again. Looks like it anyway. I don't think his team can help him out. EGM, unfortunately, doesn't have anything to help out his ally. I was looking for maybe like a four staff or something, but he's actually going the pipe route in this game. Go Bear, go. Spirit Bear runs into No-Tail. Quick jump back to Admiral Bulldog.
I don't think he wants to give it up. He understands how quickly it goes down, how quickly it has gone down so frequently.
Yeah, it's got a 50-second cooldown, so can't afford to lose this one.
Well, with how quickly OG kill it, he can't even really risk it. You notice that Bulldog is staying with his bear now, not really showing it on the map. OG just have so much mobility on their side.
S4. Sees Miracle, will be able to grab him back, but does he actually have enough mana sustain to be able to take on Miracle, who's tanky as hell? No, he's certainly not. No-Tail comes in with the assist inside the vice, and now S4 is actually going to lose his Aegis here.
They've got to make their way down, beeline to bottom to help him out.
Try and catch No-Tail, perhaps. S4 comes back. Where's the jump? They actually didn't see No-Tail, I think, with the bear. And that is a free escape from OG.
Potentially just thought there were going to be other heroes behind him. Maybe. You're walking into a blind area, saw the Sardar make his way over to, and Loda doesn't get the jump off onto No-Tail, and now they're going to start to pressure this tier 2 tower on top. Without the Aegis available, no way that Alliance take this fight.
Tier 2 it is for OG. Alliance, all they can do is maybe chip away at the tier 3 in exchange and try and force some heroes back. But Miracle is already one step ahead of them. Him rocking the 14 Bloodstone charges to S4's 3.
3, 1, and 12, No-Tail. So far, maybe the man of the match for me. He's created so much space for his team, leading in with that early Hex. Completely ruined Alliance's game plan once he grabbed that. It made it so that Storm could no longer go for these safe pickoffs. S4 finally does have that BKB. And that's this first 10-second charge on this hero is going to mean so much to them. They really need to win this fight, but all of these heroes picking up Lincoln Spears on the side of OG.
Storm Spear just not going to do anything.
Yeah, there's a Shiva's Guard too on this Tinker, and armor is so good against Storm.
Good to slow down his attack speed as well, right?
Yeah, that is the most annoying thing, because you think about it, Overload is his main way to get damage out. He needs to rely on his auto attack speed. This is why you almost always grab Orchid, even as a second item.
Right.
Even if Hex would be better just for the initiation, it's so that you can keep up the amount of DPS that you can get out. Shiva's is so good against him.
Yeah, smoke time. OG have just pushed out the mid lane. They kind of chipped away at it real quickly, and it's going to press forward. They've got some pretty good vision, but I think they'd like to get some even more wards.
Oh, they
up.
See Bulldog. This is...
It's just going to be the spear pair pushing forward.
They're just going to gank the bear.
He does have another one, so. Still, 3-inch gold. 3-inch gold.
They miscoordinated on that. Had to allow Moon to actually lead that fight.
Nice reaction, though, by Bulldog. Can you get the bear back?
Yeah. That was odd, though. They showed the TP, and that kind of tipped them off.
MKB. No longer having to worry about the laser, so finally Alliance have some sort of guaranteed damage. That Aghanim's laser was just going to destroy them in teamfights. So they just got a little something. BKB activated just in time. Good reactions here from Loda, but it costs him a charge, and he has to head back to base.
OG gathered up in full force. They're going to send Moon forward with the Lincolns. Lincolns on Lincolns.
Hotkeys almost got an angle set for himself.
They just have to, Alliance have to play the defensive game and hope that OG either get frustrated and try to make a rash move or wait for some sort of opening.
Essentially, we're going to need OG to have some sort of breakdown like Alliance did in that mid gank.
That was so weird. It happened so suddenly. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden, S4 dies, then he revives because he has a decent amount of Bloodstone charges, dies once again, gets his second consecutive death in a row, then dies a third time.
All of a sudden, the game is entirely in the hands of OG.
Yeah. Alliance really just being holed up in their base. Can't really go too far outside, especially with that jam still available on crit. And just their ability to instantly be there if Alliance get out of position.
So if you're OG, do you like never actually have an item or a timing that you go high ground? It's just when you find the right pickoffs, when you have the right control, then you go for it?
I mean, they're still gaining a lot of items on all their heroes.
Yeah.
Good amount of XP. Alliance can't leave their base, or they don't feel comfortable at least. They know that the Storm isn't really gaining much more in items, and all of their heroes are still doing quite well when it comes to net worth. Even their Phoenix. The two supports from Alliance just continue to become less effective as the game goes on. Ogre, not really the best ultra late game hero. Maybe if he had Ags plus an Aether Lens and an Octarine Core, but...
GM's gotta be so miserable.
Yeah.
Like, I was kind of joking about, like, he's just a Bloodlust, but that's essentially
really
what he's gonna become to.
Not become, is already.
It's true.
Oh, in mid.
Loda jumped on, chain stun. They're going to have Miracle coming in with the extra damage. Sue, Loda doesn't have a chance. Just chain stun constantly. S4 is going to go on to No-Tail with his BKB. And all the great attack speed, he will actually be able to take one. It looks like he'll manage to get the Phoenix Egg as well. The stun comes in, actually stalling things up. And S4, the laser stops everything. The Egg explodes. Alliance, the fight entirely resets. And now they've got a fresh Sunray burning through Bulldog. He's almost dead. Crit managed to catch up to him. The Savage Roar goes down, but Miracle's still able to catch him with the edge of the Shivas. Loda, the target next as they get control onto him with the help of Crit. That's a dieback for Loda. And Alliance struggling to keep any control of this game as they're going to lose EGM as well. OG may have just found their opportunity to go high ground.
So well done by OG taking that fight. Alliance didn't even look that bad of a fight for a second. That first BKB charge on that Storm Spirit doing a lot of work there, but that laser to save the Phoenix Egg. Maybe Alliance can make something out of that fight if that doesn't happen. They were about to bring down the Phoenix Egg. They had Loda hitting it on top of the Storm Spirit, who attacks really fast. Neither of them were Fire Spirited or anything, but OG jump at the bit.
Yeah, the Bloodlust on the Storm Spirit seemed like it was almost inevitable that Egg was not going to be able to survive. But the bouncing laser, man. Bouncing laser.
Axon, the Keeper of the Light, though, is going to continue to do okay for them as they can play the vision game decently. But OG looked like they want to get aggressive. They don't have Egg available yet. Maybe even wait for that. Phoenix.
Gank on the Spirit Bear, perhaps. No tail. He's in.
Oh, looks like it is going to be a gank on the Spirit Bear.
It goes to the Scythe, but Miracle's a little bit late in TPing in. And oh, he actually does catch it. Gets the Shivas on him. They slow down the Bear, and that will be a kill.
Another 300 gold, and that is so hard for that bear. Poor bear. BKB coming out on Bulldog. I think he understands that he needs to be able to keep that thing alive.
Rapidly turning into an endangered animal. More cliff games for No-Tail. Getting some vision for his team. He really does seem to play that game quite well. Vision game. Information.
Lions are just holed up in their base right now. Gonna get scanned out.
OG just kind of making sure that was like sort of they're in their base, right? Not smoking out or anything. What was that kind of scan?
Yeah, it was make sure you know where they're supposed to be. They've just kind of forced them into prison of their own base.
Even with that was supposed to be advantage, right? The Keeper of the Light plus the Storm Spirit is that, and the Aghanim Spirit Bear, is that you would always be able to push out the lane and still remain safe. What we're seeing with the way that OG are coordinating, that not even the Spirit Bear is going to be able to stay alive as the Sunrage just burns it down. That's down for 84 seconds. OG didn't push high ground last time I suggested it, but maybe third time's the charm. Loda going to be jumped on, quickly stunned up, chaining it with crit, but no follow-up. OG just kind of testing the waters of high ground for now. No-Tail puts himself in the front lines with his blade mail. Lotus stuck inside the trees and the sun ray burning through him. The Scythe of Ice, and he's forced to pop a BKB. OG, a small victory in the long drawn out war that is this tier 3 push.
With that bear dead, all of that net worth that he built up, 26k, it's considerable, but obviously not going to do too much as mid.
TP on the move.
Gonna get jumped on.
Four still managed to get the jump away, though. Miracle doesn't have the hard lockdown of sight, thanks to the fact he went Ethereal Blade. So that 1-2 punch isn't going to be enough to stop a Storm Spirit. Maybe next time around they'll have No-Tail joining them, though. Again, time after time, Moon trying Alliance, seeing if there's a weak point somewhere in that high ground defense, and they are getting a small bit of damage on the tier threes. Loda thinking about, oh, Lincoln's actually comes out. Lotus gonna be turned around on, thought he was gonna be able to get the duel. Instead, he's the one who ends up going down. Nothing given, nothing gained. S4, BKB activated, but Supernova goes down, and Alliance are forced to retreat back to the fountain without Loda. Again, 60 seconds on him as he died back last team fight. Now EGM's gone as well. Alliance going to have to give up a full lane of racks, it seems.
Yeah, this is not something that they can really defend. They're going to send the Storm forward with some shenanigans of the Keeper of the Light combination, but this is definitely going to mean set of racks. They've got to be careful, too. They've got Hexes still.
Oh no, Ake's down as well. Beyond Godlike for Miracle. Quick buyback by him. But it's not just one lane of racks at this point in time. It's rapidly going to be turning into two if they lose this Spirit Bear for the third time in just 3 minutes now. There, sure enough, it goes down. Emerald Boulder going to be the next one burst. Miracle just going through the revolver. That is his spells. S4 gets Scythe of Ice up. Not going to be able to have a follow-up there as Moon misses out of the crush. And S4 should be able to get back to the fountain. Ake, not so lucky. Yet another dieback for Alliance.
That is a godlike Phoenix. 10, 1, and 12. He has so many different items. Didn't even realize, but he's got a sacrifice of his own. Is
managed
S4
to get the Orchid and stopping that TP out there. No tail. If they could just get Moon as well. No, again, these Lincolns saving the individual heroes of OG time after time. So they only get the one pick off of the lane of rags and multiple buybacks and diebacks.
Everyone on OG is so farmed. Like this, Phoenix has a Lincoln Sphere and a Scythe of Ice. It makes it so impossible for Alliance to get any sort of maneuverability out.
Uh-huh. Aether Lens versus Larva.
What is Miracle dropping?
I mean,
for that Ethblade, by the way. The Aether?
But what is Aether Lens on Sardar?
I longer cast range of
amplified
damage.
I was like, is this a Moon thing? Is he going to start dropping? Is this his drop item? He picked up Aether Lens. He's just going to start dropping it in team fights?
No, I don't think he does that anymore. Changed man.
I don't know about that.
Yep. Alliance are just kind of waiting for OG to push into them. As, again, they're in a similar situation. This time down Arrakis, though.
It just seems inevitable at this point that the wave of OG heroes are going to be able to penetrate the high ground once again and finish this game off.
Oh, No-Tail actually TPs into that, but
Scythe of Ice leading onto the Baron. They quickly wake the Bear up, press the attack.
No-Tail's getting pretty low.
Keep on attempting this Ball Lightning recall back as a form of high ground defense quickly burst down the wave, but not quite getting it perfectly. The laser goes down, Alliance dropping pretty quickly now. The long jump in, but again, it's just a recall back. Bringing OG a bit low. Miracle doesn't mind, he'll just head back to base. BRB, he says, jump in from the Storm Spirit again, getting some damage onto No-Tail. Waiting for that heal up frantically trying to bottle. Maybe he can actually get a finishing blow on somebody, but the problem with these global heroes, just head on right back to the Radiant base.
This has got to be the most frustrating situation for OG, and this is saying something considering they're the ones with Tinker in the game, which is a notoriously defensive hero. But Alliance are just holding the line, using the Storm Spirit ball repeatedly, clearing the wave.
Okay, if they could actually start getting this timing like perfected, that mid-creep wave's never actually going to be able to breach the high ground. They just have to deal with the side lanes at this point. OG, they're like, fine, enough with your shenanigans. Let's get ourselves an Aegis and cheese.
Who does this even then benefit we'll that much on OG? I guess they could get it on anybody and just decide to go for it.
Yeah, in some ways it stops. It denies the way from Alliance, right? In that freak scenario that OG loses a fight while they're trying to push high ground and Alliance gets some semblance of control, they would love to be able to get an Aegis for the Storm Spirit.
The cool thing about Alliance's draft, though, is maybe if they do this a few more times, OG slip up and get a little bit too frustrated. Like, Dota players are also prone to human emotion. Mm-hmm. You can have this happen to you a few times and OG might just think to themselves, we have to do something, I'm tired of this game.
I mean, with the way that this game has gone, Blitz, I'm not going to say a few more times. I don't think you want to raise the hopes of the crowd too much. I think it's going to be a few more hundred times at this rate. Scythe onto the Spirit Bear. Another exciting attempt at a Spirit Bear kill. Looks like they do have it in the bag. There is an extra one for Admiral Bulldog, though. Oh, actually pops the BKB to be able to keep it intact. The amplify damage. Moon, careful there, friend. Shiva's coming out. It's a Storm Spirit. That has to be one of the most ridiculous things I've ever watched. No Tail's going to try and go high ground anyway with the help of Miracle. Moon jumps in, managed to get the stun on EGM. Next round, a Storm Spirit bursting down the creep wave and getting some chip damage onto the rest of OG. And again, OG, you're right. Maybe they are going to be misstepping here.
They are getting pretty low.
A little too low. Maybe this is the one. Hey, maybe they can't actually get a jump here. Moon going to be rooted up, managed to get the stun. Okay, never mind. Spirit Bear's going to go down again. Laser goes out. Alliance now have to back out. They're all too low. Miracle's going to be able to come in big time and maybe clean up multiple kills or at least force out the BKB. Loda now just going to get right clicked by No-Tail. Nice hit there from the Blinding Light, but it's not enough to be able to save Loda. S4 destroyed. Gets Scythe of Ice up right underneath the Burning Sun. And OG take full control of the mid lane. S4, time and time again, trying to jump in, trying to disrupt the OG push high ground, but it's just not happening. OG, they played it safe, they played it conservative, and they built themselves enough of an advantage that they will not be pushed back. And it ends not with a bang, but a whimper S4. For Alliance.
He gives them a smiley face. That's so sadistic.
That was very sadistic.
Like, good game, smiley face.
I mean, it was the same treatment by both teams. That was the ridiculousness of it. The first 25 minutes of the game, it was like Alliance doing this kind of like dance around, like, haha, we're farming, you're not actually doing anything. And the game was just crawling at a snail's speed. But then OG got the control, right? And then they did the same thing. They just
jokes on
like
you, Cloud.
Yeah, they're like, oh, yeah, that was a fun game, wasn't it, Alliance? Wasn't it? Yeah. How about a little bit of taste of your own medicine? Well, that was an interesting series to say the least, I'm sure. Our analysts have all kinds of theory crafting to do about the Storm Spirit Keeper of the Light combo.
Yes, okay. Where do we start with that one? Let's find out from our panel, because I'm sure they've got some interesting thoughts on that one. It was a rather long game, probably longer than it probably should have been, Toby. 52 minutes and 14, 34-6, Miracle 14-0-13. A dominant performance by OG throughout. Potentially a little bit passive at times, but they just wanted to play it safe, I guess, and get through the game. But that was an awfully long game for something that felt inevitable from about the fifth minute.
Yeah, when Loda died straight away on the bottom lane, and Bulldog dies within the space of the next like 30 seconds in the mid lane, you're like, well, okay, well, the early initiator of strength I was looking for out Lotus not really going to come. Bulldog's quick transition, like, it still came, but it took some time.
Mm.
But at that point, like, I don't think OG ever really felt fearful when they went in for a gank or any kind of maneuver.
Yeah, I mean, played it safe because they wanted to play it safe and get through the game. Shiva, just slightly disappointed because we were very excited about like a lovely draft and it was very different and we saw some new stuff in the patch. And
I was rooting for our freedom.
It didn't work though.
It didn't at all, and I kind of feel like, you know, if you're gonna have box strat, great. But if you're already going to get counted in the first two picks, maybe try to shift it slightly so that you can deal better with everything, with the Phoenix, with the Slardar, with the Tinker later on as well. It's just, that was not a good game to end on. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, and let's talk about the Storm of Spirit as well, Purge, because
It was good.
It never really got going.
It was good.
Well, it wasn't allowed to, was it?
I like their strat. It's just they literally had the two Lone Druid counters, and their strat was based around amping up the Lone Druid, kind of, or some other cores. So it fell really flat, and it completely reminded me of the first game they played where Alliance moved around the map looking for kills, and OG knew where they were going to be because they guessed and they predicted, and they never got kills. Mm. And then S4 farmed less because you sit around trying to get kills. And then their strat never got online. Until the end, we saw it. Like, until that happened, I was like, this strat's not very good. It's, like, kind of cool, but it doesn't look amazing. When he started doing that recall thing, I was like, that's abusive. That's, like, actually as bad as Tinker late game with that much farm. It was pretty incredible how effective it was at counter-pushing.
Also, Miracle, another great game from Miracle yet again. 14-0-13. Doesn't really tell the full story of his game, but this guy is pretty good, isn't he?
Super good performance, different hero, completely different build than nobody ever does, but it was exactly what they needed. With the Ags, the laser bounces, complete counter to Lone Druid.
Yeah, I'm kind of glad he did that because it's exactly what we spoke about in between game one and game two about how he can change whatever he needs to do to get through the game to give his team what they need.
With the Aether Lens as well, so he could cast it from far away. It would bounce from the bear to all the other heroes, which is tons of damage amp, and you'd shoot four missiles, so they just got cleaved down basically by
nuke
damage.
The League memes, though. I don't like those too much.
I don't know what you're talking about. I have no...
Tons
I don't even
damage.
Know what you're talking about.
Yeah,
what,
actually, I don't have any idea. You're the only one here that gets that joke. That's abandoned ship, definitely. Move on.
Dive on!
We're not on your side here.
Toby.
Oh, Red.
What can we take away from this that Alliance can be positive about?
I don't know. Not much.
Okay,
Shiva. They managed to make Purge happy because they found another abusive thing inside of Dota 2.
Yes, that is a positive.
That's a positive. Of course, the only time you can ever use it is when you're losing. On the edge of losing your base.
Yeah.
Yeah, which is particularly helpful because by then it's probably GG. Shiva, give us some light. Keeper of the Light inspiration.
At the start of this game, or before this game rather, you asked us what Alliance need to do different.
Yes.
In the second game to try and beat OG.
And they did different.
And yes, but we talked about how they needed to up the tempo and do more, and then they pick a lineup that basically does less, and they were...
Hey, they could have done more.
I have written down,
what have we
do
got?
Something to... that this
she actually does.
Toby.
She literally has do something
I
written
have
down.
Do something hyphen Toby, because Toby said, Alliance, do something. And then, they didn't
they
at that
They
point.
Had the chance. I wonder if the Nature's Prophet pick actually kind of threw them off a little bit. Like, where they thought, okay, now we just go into something which we tried a long time ago, which is like bear buff kind of scenario, as opposed to having, like, we have a minion wave, we have a lone draw behind it, and we just start pushing, right? Like maybe
minion?
That was the whole
did
thing.
Did you hear that? I heard minion just
I
now.
I did too, yeah. This is descending.
You're dead
summons,
to me, Toby.
What? If you're dead summons to me. Is closer to League of Legends if you want to start doing that.
Wow, I really Toby.
So. All we need to do is just make it in the middle of the stage, and we got summoners in.
Everything Toby? You just said negated. I don't
Toby.
Even care anymore.
Yes.
We've had some problems with Toby in the past.
We've had many problems with me in the past.
Toby's an ass. We'll not be working with Toby again.
That's cool. I don't think I'm on the desk again.
Okay, cool. Good. Wipes away. So,
I'm on the desk once more, actually.
Are you really? Yeah, you better be careful.
But don't worry. Like, don't worry. Like, if Swindles gets knocked out in the first round, I get replaced.
Wow. We've had some fun with the drafts. Yeah. And I don't want to be too dismissive of Alliance because they have shown that they're not a pushover. They've shown some of their passion again and the fact that they can hang with the best teams here. They've gone down twice to OG in a row, though, so that it may just be a matchup thing, potentially. I'm searching a little bit for why, and I don't necessarily feel like they played particularly badly in either of the two games today, or when they played OG before didn't really feel like they played terribly in either of the, any of the four games they played against them, but they've lost all four, and that's kind of unusual when you play a team twice.
Yeah, I do sort of agree. I think it might be a matchup problem because they just couldn't find kills. Shiver pointed out, do something. Yeah. They tried to do stuff,
but
they
couldn't
get the kills.
But do you know, do you think that was maybe why we've had this weirder draft from them as well? Because they've just gone, you know what, we've tried the three standards, that let's do something really crazy.
Yeah, it's...
Yeah, there's crazy, and then there's removing synergy. You pick up a Storm Spirit as your fifth, and it's like, well, okay, why do I have to get this? It's so I can catch out Prophet and Tinker, so S4 can make plays, so we can give them a playmaking.